Oh my gosh, it's a brain! No, but seriously, we have finally gotten to the part where we talk about the brain. I mean, we talked about the brain, but just how it forms and gets developed from the neural tube. We talked about how all those neurons form and develop. Remember all those fancy pants stuff from option A1? Neurogenesis, plasticity, neural pruning? Well, we're moving on, and now we're gonna start to learn about the mushy gushy brain. I'm not really sure why we're learning about the brain. We don't really use it for anything. Well, I don't use my brain, at least. You probably use yours. I mean, for everything. Everything. The essential idea here is simple. The parts of the brain specialize in different functions. You probably already knew that, but unfortunately, that's not good enough, and we gotta get the specifics on this stuff. In case you forgot, or needed some background, here's our cool nervous system chart. If you locate the brain on this, you can see we are still focusing on the central nervous system, but not on the spinal cord. So our lecture today is brought to you courtesy of the brain. P.S. Before I forget, make sure you check YouTube for Pinky and the Brain. They were these kooky characters on this 1990s show called Animaniacs. I think that you will enjoy. First up, we cannot discuss the brain without briefly talking about how the brain is formed and tying this back to our topic in neural development. As you now know, the embryo's neural tube develops in humans sometime around the third week. Recall that we have a cranial end, this is the head, and the caudal end, which is the tail. These are also known as the anterior and posterior, anterior being the head and posterior being tail. The majority of the neural tube develops into the spinal cord. This seems logical, as the spinal cord is relatively long. The anterior end becomes the brain. Roughly 1 month into the embryonic development, there are three distinct parts of the early brain: the forebrain, the midbrain, and the hindbrain. These structures will eventually give rise to the identifiable components of the developed brain, which you can see in the middle part of that image. The brain is massively important, but is not massive in mass. It accounts for roughly 2% of the body's mass, but it consumes 20% of the body's energy need. It's kind of like the United States of energy consumption. We don't have as many people as other countries in the world, but we consume a lot more. So there are two simple reasons for this. First, energy is needed to maintain a resting potential when neurons are not firing. So the sodium-potassium pump is an active pump, meaning it requires energy in the form of ATP. The second reason is to make the necessary neurotransmitters for the neurons to communicate and send messages. So when your synapses need to make those neurotransmitters like acetylcholine, it's gotta produce them. While there is little variation on the brain's usage of energy based on physical exertion, the brain does consume more glucose energy when your neurons and brains are firing and when you're using your brain more. More specifically, the developed brain is not uniform. Different parts have very, very specific roles. Our body systems are controlled and regulated here, and you definitely need to know these parts of the brain and be able to identify them in the photograph, diagram, or scan of the brain. There are three main parts of the developed brain: the cerebral cortex, the cerebellum, and the brainstem. The cerebral cortex is an outer layer of tissue organized into two hemispheres and composed of four distinct lobes. The frontal lobe controls motor activity and tasks associated with the dopamine system, things like memory and attention. The parietal lobe is responsible for touch sensation, which is called tactility, as well as spatial navigation. The temporal lobe is involved in auditory processing and language comprehension, and the occipital lobe is the visual processing center of the brain and is responsible for sight perception. The cerebellum appears as a different structure at the base of the brain underneath the cerebral hemispheres, and it's responsible for coordinating unconscious motor functions such as balance and movement coordinations. The brainstem connects to the spinal cord, which relays signals to and from the body and includes the pons, medulla oblongata, which is often referred to as the medulla, and the midbrain. The brainstem controls automatic and involuntary activities like breathing, swallowing, and your heart rate. Inside the brain, we have the hypothalamus, the pituitary gland, and the corpus callosum. The hypothalamus functions as the interface with the pituitary gland, and as you hopefully remember, helps to maintain homeostasis via the coordination of the nervous and endocrine system. The hypothalamus also produces some hormones directly, which are secreted via the posterior pituitary. The pituitary gland is the master gland. It produces hormones that regulate other glands and target organs, so follicle-stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone, growth hormone, and prolactin, ADH, and oxytocin. It is a hormone-producing machine. Lastly, the corpus callosum is a bundle of nerve fibers that connects the two cerebral hemispheres and is the largest white matter structure in the brain, consisting of roughly 250 million axon projections. That is a lot of axons. Damage to the corpus callosum can prevent information exchange between left and right hemispheres, which can result in split brain disorders. Below, You can see the photograph, diagram, and MRI scan, and you definitely should be able to identify the main exterior and interior parts that were just mentioned in the previous two slides. How do we know all the rad things we know about this fancy pants piece of human equipment called the brain? Well, it turns out we use a variety of things to learn more all the time. And as our technology improves, our ability to better understand brain science also improves. There are four main things we do: animal experiments, autopsies, lesions, so through MRI or CT scans, and fMRI scans. Each has some unique advantages as well as some disadvantages. Some examples are given here as well for you, though I won't dive into those myself. Animal experiments are exactly as it sounds, experiments on animals. Because such methods are highly invasive and potentially damaging to humans, animal models are frequently used. Experimentation on animals involves less ethical restrictions than human studies, although we do still have ethical standards for using animals. However, animal studies are limited by the differences between animal and human brains, and this makes valid comparisons difficult. Autopsies are post-mortem examinations of a corpse via dissection in order to evaluate causes of death. The researcher can benefit by making comparisons between the brains of healthy and diseased corpses to identify affected brain areas. However, the corpses are deceased, meaning no live brain activity can be studied. Lesions are abnormal areas of brain tissue, which can indicate the effect of the loss of a brain area. Lesions can be identified via postmortem analysis, so an autopsy, or via scans of the brain, whether it's a CAT scan or a CT scan, or the MRI. So patients alive or not can be studied. However, effects of lesions can be difficult to identify, as many functions may involve multiple brain areas. Additionally, the brain has the capacity to relearn certain skills by rerouting or sprouting, as we've learned about previously, and instructions to these other areas. And we've learned about this and know it as plasticity. Lastly, fMRIs can be used to identify activated areas of the brain. Oxygenated hemoglobin responds differently to a magnetic field than deoxygenated hemoglobin. These differences in oxygenation can be represented visually and reflect differences in the level of brain activity. The benefit here is that an fMRI is non-invasive and can be used to identify multiple brain regions involved in complex integrated brain activities. There are three key parts of the cerebral hemispheres that are specialized to carry out certain functions that we need to be aware of: the visual cortex, Broca's area, and the nucleus accumbens. The visual cortex is the region of the brain responsible for visual perception and is located within the occipital lobe of the cerebrum and receives neural impulses from light-sensitive cells in the eyes. And we're going to focus on this in our next section, A3. So we will learn all about the visual cortex and how the eyes do this work. Broca's area is responsible for speech production and is located within the frontal lobe of the left cerebral hemisphere, so it's not present in the right hemisphere. If damaged, the individual cannot produce meaningful speech despite intending to. So if someone tries to tell you Broca's area is in the right hemisphere, you know that they're using their Broca's area, but they're incorrect about the location. It's only in the left hemisphere. The nucleus accumbens is involved in the pleasure reward pathway and is found within each cerebral hemisphere. It secretes neurotransmitters responsible for feelings of pleasure, so dopamine, and satiety, so serotonin. It also communicates with other centers involved in mechanisms of pleasure, such as the ventral tegmental area, the VTA. As you know from a few slides ago, the cerebral cortex is the outer layer of neural tissue in the cerebrum of chordate. The cerebral cortex does fancy complex things like memory, perception, consciousness, and thought. However, not all chordate cerebral cortices are the same. Check out the rat brain versus the human brain. Look at how many folds, wrinkles, and troughs the human brain has in comparison. This is super important. Technically, the folding is called gyrification, and gyrification is a predictor of cognitive capacity in chordates. So the more gyrification, the more cognitive capacity an organism has. Through evolution, human brains have become enlarged not by size, but by gyrification. The gyrification allows more neurons to be present, which you can see in the graph, and ultimately, the more neural capacity, the higher the cognitive capacity. It's kind of like a computer with a higher processing speed. The cerebral hemispheres themselves are responsible for higher order functions like memory, speech, cognitive thought, problem solving, attention, and emotions. As you probably already know, the brain has a right hemisphere and a left hemisphere. Most complex tasks are found in both hemispheres, and this is contrary to popular belief. You know, the whole right brain versus left brain thing? Nope. But it's worth pointing out that some activities are only localized on a single side. One thing that fascinates me about our brain is that our brains have contralateral processing. That means that things that occur on the left side of our body is processed by the right hemisphere of the brain, and vice versa. Tactile information, like touch, from the left side of the body is transferred to the right side of the spinal cord or brainstem. Visual information from the left visual field is transferred to the right cerebral cortex at the optic chiasma. And you can see this in the image below. Tying it back to our learning about strokes in the last section, if an individual has a stroke on the right side of the brain, the left side of their body is actually affected, and vice versa. In the brainstem, we have the medulla oblongata, also simply called the medulla. The medulla is responsible for coordinating the autonomic activities. You can see on the right that the autonomic nervous system consists of the sympathetic and parasympathetic responses. All of them are autonomic, though. You don't even have to think about them. Sympathetic responses are the fight or flight responses, things like dilating pupils, increasing heartbeat, relaxed airways, inhibited stomach activities. If you ever know of someone who loses their lunch when they get really nervous, this might be why. The parasympathetic are the rest and digest response and the opposite of the fight or flight, like constricted pupils, slower heartbeat, digestion in the stomach, and reproductive stimulation. The medulla uses noradrenaline and acetylcholine to regulate these processes, and the autonomic nervous system is essentially one automatic response system. For example, breathing and heart rate are good links to topics we've already learned about. It is one big response mechanism. To just discuss one, when your body's cells have more carbon dioxide, like when you're working out, your blood pH level decreases. This tells the chemical receptors in the medulla to release noradrenaline as the sympathetic nerves stimulate, and causes your lungs to increase the rate of contractions and the heart to also beat faster via the sinoatrial node. Ultimately, this brings more oxygen into your lungs, into your bloodstream, and to the body's cells. You can see that the opposite is true when carbon dioxide concentration decreases. This is how the autonomic nervous system works, just like that automatic. Another application that is important to understand is the pupil reflex. It too is part of the autonomic nervous system and is involuntary and based on the amount of light present and perceived by the photoreceptor. Our pupils, which are the dark middle parts of the eyes, get larger and smaller. In bright light, the pupils get smaller, or they constrict, and in less light, the pupils dilate or get larger in size. This has to do with getting the best use of our photoreceptors without overstimulating them. It turns out the pupil reflex, which is automatic, is a good indicator of measuring the amount of brain damage a person might have after an injury or severe health complication, like a stroke. Specifically, brain death is defined as a permanent absence of measurable activity in both the cerebrum and brainstem, and it can be determined by medical professionals that are testing the autonomic response system. One of these tests used is the pupil reflex. And you can see in the chart on the right the Glasgow Coma Scale that health professionals use to diagnose neurological activity. And you can see it for motor response, verbal response, and also eye opening. The last important skill you should be able to do is to analyze the correlation between body size and brain size in different animals. It's pretty straightforward, but as you can see from the graph, there's a positive correlation, meaning the larger animals have larger brains. It's not 100% linear, and it's not 100% proportional, but you can still see that the positive correlation. Scientists look at the encephalization, which is the amount of brain mass relative to body size. In mammals, the brain-to-body ratio is used to make an encephalization quotient, or an EQ, that attempts to provide a rough estimate of potential cognition. However, it's worth pointing out that there's not a correlation between brain size and intelligence. But remember that this does not include the idea of gyrification that we discussed earlier. So, hopefully you learned all about the brain, the various parts, and functions. In our next episode, we will be learning about how the brain perceives different stimuli, like light, sound, chemicals, heat, and focusing on the eyes and ears specifically and how they function. As always, it's really important to give credit where it's due. While the presentation script and video are solely of my own creation, many of the images and information contained in the presentation are not. So shoutouts to the following. Most of the images and video clips come from IB Bio Ninja, and some of the information used. Other images and info come from Bionology, iBiology, and Biology for Life. Lastly, some information was gleaned from the Cambridge edition of the IB Biology text, as the intended purpose of this presentation is to provide you with yet another resource tool to enhance your learning for the IB Biology curriculum. Many thanks.